Welcome to the XY Advisor Podcast, where it's our goal to help you become the best financial advisor possible and drive the positive evolution of financial advice. Hub24 is an ASX-listed company with over $15 billion funds under management and one of the fastest-growing platforms in the market. Neither a bank nor part of a bank, Hub24 focuses entirely on connecting advisors to a broad range of investment solutions for their clients. Discover why other advisors think Hub24 are the best in the market and access the benefits of choice and efficiency for you and your clients with their market-leading managed portfolio solution. To find out more, visit hub24.com.au.
Jade Eley.
Ray Jaramas.
Hi.
Good, mate.
Yeah.
Good to see you again.
What's been happening?
Oh, lots. Just, you know, busy end of the year like everyone, I'm sure, running around, getting stuff done, trying to tie up a few loose ends before we go on break for a little while. So, yeah,
all good. How's family?
Family's good. Expanded since I saw you last. We've got a little daughter, Piper, who's 9 months old now, so she's keeping us busy and slightly sleep deprived, but not too bad.
Yeah. How are you balancing it?
Fortunately I've got a wife who's on mat leave who is doing the night shifts and sort of letting me get a bit of sleep because I'm sort of doing fairly long hours at the moment. But yeah, we're juggling it fine and somehow finding our way through it all for the first time. But yeah.
How are you doing the modelling for your daycare? Daycare. Because I started looking at this for clients, it's like $120, $140 a day.
Jeez, I haven't even really looked into it that much, apart from getting our names down with as many places as possible. Because I haven't even looked at the cost side. It's just so competitive trying to actually get in the door with anywhere.
Yeah.
All the places we've spoken to said that it's, basically, 3 months to 12 months waiting list.
Seriously.
Yeah, so I've just pushed the cost to the side. It will be what it will be. I'll have to find the finances for it.
Yeah, man.
Review the budgeting afterwards.
For a lot of the clients that I'm working with now, it's like buying first property, having kids, those sorts of things. And when you put the daycare costs in, it's like, thank God of like primary school kicks in from five, because staggering, man. I don't fully understand the rebate side of things, but there must be an adjustment, because if you're earning like an average salary in Sydney and you have to pay for full daycare. Mm.
Oh, it's definitely, there's a tiered rebate system based on, your combined incomes and everything. But I think, for a lot of people, you really have to look at, is it really worth that the spouse not working, working that extra day because of the extra costs? Like, you have to be getting a decent wage to offset some of that. So,
yeah.
And plus you get the benefits of spending a bit more time with your kid if you don't have them in daycare. So, sometimes it doesn't always have to be financial. You get that sort of feel good and lifestyle factor as well by spending more time with them.
Cool. Well, for people who might not have met you when you were in Sydney previously, do you want to tell us a little bit about your story? So Jade and I went to Horizons 7 years ago.
Oh, God. It would have been 2011, 12, right about then.
At the time, Jade was on the cusp of deciding whether or not to spend his time on Triple J or AMP, and he sits in front of me now.
God,
so
isn't that a bit of a sad choice to make, isn't it?
Yeah.
In hindsight.
Yeah. Well, tell us. Like, I'm super excited. I actually don't remember. So, like, and I always struggled with the idea of like sitting like in AMP where there's like this big floor of like 50, 60 people, and there's like you there with like this fancy haircut, living in Paddington, spending your evenings doing band practice when everyone else is like reading up on their DFP.
Yeah, it was a bit of a different life then, but I guess we all moved to Sydney back in, would have been 2008, from Adelaide, me and the guys I used to play in the band with. The band's called I Know Leopard, just a small plug there. Still going well on Triple J and all the festival scenes and whatnot.
Yeah.
But we all moved over to Sydney, and I got my start in the finance world working with AMP Direct.
That's right.
Had a few family contacts through AMP, and they sort of helped me get the foot in the door whilst I was doing my original DFP all those years ago. And so I started out there. I was living in Bondi and working in Parramatta at the AMP office there, where we were sort of started in the sales support and retention team. taking a lot of inbound calls, and then moved to the direct sales team, which I have no idea whether that still exists in general advice land.
So what is AMP Direct? Is someone calls up, wants income protection, and you can just give it to them?
Actually, it was a lot of it at that time was outbound phone calls to existing AMP clients talking about, do they want to review what they've got? Yeah, definitely. Thinking about it now straddles the personal and general advice, and a bit of blurred lines.
Yeah,
there,
right,
which,
yeah.
I think they probably had to revise that business model.
I think
AMP
are reviewing a couple of things at the moment, yeah.
But they, so I was doing that for a while, and obviously, you know, making 140 outbound calls a day wasn't really what I wanted to be doing, was much more drawn to the relationship side of things in financial advice. So once I finished some of the studies, moved across to St. Leonard's, where we did Horizons together. And
you were there for the full year, right?
Yeah, I did the full 12 months there, so I could get the, you know, full end-to-end experience. I mean, as much as it was an interesting little microcosm of an environment there, I kind of found it quite beneficial, because I don't think I would have been ready at the time, coming from somewhere like AMP Direct and having some qualifications, to going straight into reviewing clients, you know, new client appointments, being productive. Like, you know, it was 100%. Just quite a big gap from sales in that kind of environment to being a, you know, fully fledged advisor, obviously.
Yeah.
But so I did the full 12 months there, and obviously had good mates like you and Adrian and Clayton and Graham and a few others that are still in the few of us that are still left in the profession. And following the full 12 months there, where I was kind of, as you were saying, on half band duties, half financial advice duties.
And was that, because like, that's a weird thing for advice, but like, was that weird for your bandmates to have, you're the dude wearing the tie?
I was the suit.
Were you?
But, only in business hours. As soon as we finished, the tie came off, the skinny jeans were on, and I was ready to go. But, no, it was a really weird sort of profession to be doing whilst in a touring band as well. But
because those Horizons hours were not short, right? So that, no. I mean, like, your days would, like, I don't know what, like, AMP from, like, I don't know, 8 o'clock in the morning, 7 o'clock,
you know, sort of 8 o'clock, and then we'd finish up 6 or 7, and then I'd get to band practice at like 8:30, practice till midnight. That was probably 2 or 3 nights a week.
Yeah.
And get home like 1 o'clock.
Jules would
get
up thrilled.
Yeah, she was loving it. Yeah. It wasn't seeing me much at all. She was loving getting to go to festivals and stuff, though. So there was the other side. But it was a bit of a strange sort of combination of things to be doing. But
how are you feeling during it?
During it, a little bit conflicted, because I was really enjoying the career progression and where that was all going, and feeling quite fulfilled from the job and future prospects. But at the same time, I've always loved playing music and writing music and being like, you know, that's my only creative outlet. I'm no good at drawing or doing
financial modeling.
Like, yeah, financial. The rigidity of spreadsheets. Really freestyling it. But I really enjoyed having that outlet, and getting to do live performing with all the guys and eventually the girls that were in the band was awesome. And I definitely miss that to this day. But catching up with the guys in a couple of weeks, they're down here playing some shows. And
so we're still
really good mates. Yeah. Get to see them semi-regularly whenever one of us is, you know, in Sydney or Adelaide. But, you know, they're doing their thing. And I'm kind of, you know, looking back now on where I'm at, career-wise and family-wise, I think I made the right decision, because it was kind of at a crossroads where I kept doing something that I loved, music-wise, that was not in any way, shape or form financially rewarding at all.
Yeah.
Versus something.
But on the cusp of, right?
Quite potentially. But yeah. I mean, even still, it's very hard to, you really have to be in that top 1-5% of bands in the country to actually be able to do it, I think, full time for a living. But, you know, on the other hand, I was really passionate about financial advice and working within my family's business, which had been around at that stage for about, you know, 25 years or so. And what the future options were there with, you know, taking over the business as what I've done now sort of 4 or 5 years ago. I think I made the right choice. It was the right time to sort of segue across into something else.
Was that at the end of Horizons that you sort of said to the guys, listen, I'm out?
Yeah, it was after we finished the Horizons year, I had my father, Phil, who had his Hillross practice for since the early 80s, mid-80s or so.
Yeah.
He had another associate advisor in the office at the time, and he was probably, what was he, about 60-odd, so he's thinking about his succession planning and what's going to happen with all the clients that he's knows and spent all the time with long-term. So he sort of gave me a bit of an ultimatum of either you come down and work within the business and we work together on transitioning this over time, or I'm going to have to look at other options with existing staff or new people coming in, and you might not get that opportunity again later on. So
yeah.
I kind of juggled it and thought, well, no, I'd be crazy not to take that opportunity and run with it. And
yeah,
So we relocated back to Adelaide in mid-2013 to pretty much just work with existing clients within the business. And took it from there, really.
Do you still play?
Yeah, fortunately, I've finally got a great band room set up at my house now, so I've got all my equipment there. Unfortunately, I've got a daughter that likes to sleep whenever I'm not at the office, so I haven't been able to... You can't play the electric guitar quietly. You need to crank it. And it just, so it's just not the same as it used to be, but I'm getting some level of enjoyment.
Yeah, okay, good. Yeah. Good, man. Yeah. So tell me about the business, because like that... I'm super fascinated with that. Like before financial planning, I worked in my family business. It was
furniture.
And working with family, like it feels like this romantic idea that it should work really well. It's a succession thing. It's like it just
in theory, it's
fantastic. But you know, when it's like the fifth Thursday in a row of like having dinner talking about work shit,
yeah,
it's like. It gets testing.
Yeah, I definitely feel that. My relationship with my dad, Phil, look, professionally we get on really well and we kind of know that we need to, respect each other's, approaches from things, and we're both going to look at things slightly differently.
Yeah.
Like Phil's, got a huge heart. He's, a guy who would do anything for his clients, but his approach is probably a bit different, a bit more old school than the way I do it. But it definitely has been a bit weird for our relationship together, because I do find that, whenever we're hanging out socially as a family, like we can't stop bloody talking about work, which is, I'm sure everyone that works in this profession would agree that it's something you can't just switch off from at the end of the day. Like it stays with you. You're always thinking about it. There's always something you should be doing or could be doing that you end up talking about. It's the same with my mates that are in financial 100%, advice as well. Yeah. Whenever I see them, all we do is talk shop. It's a bit depressing, really. Surely you've got something better to talk about, but you just revert back to, all that kind of stuff. So, it's been a bit – I'd say that the it probably has compromised the social side of things with my family a little bit, but, professionally we work really well together, and I have to take my hat off to the old man. He's been pretty keen to embrace any changes that I've wanted to try and bring into the practice, because, and not all of which have been my ideas either. I mean, a lot of the time, you just, all you know is what you know from the previous roles you've had and your experience and things. And sometimes when you've got new people coming into the business that have got different ideas and backgrounds, they can come up with stuff that just changes the way you do things. And Phil's been really good at wanting to implement that in the way he's doing it, surprisingly.
I notice you call him Phil. Is that like a default thing to clients?
Cannot call him dad. Cannot work in the office and call my old man dad at work. No.
Yeah.
Especially when it's my business now. It's that awkward chain of command and, with staff and things. It's weird. Yeah.
I'm fascinated. So listening to this would be a lot of advisors that like might not be working for in the family business, but still like got an established business, been around for 25-30 years, mid-60s owner, like you can picture the dude, right?
I know a lot of them.
So what did you and Phil do anything to like any structures, or did you engage anyone as like a third party? How did you guys go about?
Well, I think we're both probably We talk. Are you talking about from the succession planning side of things,
or just how
we approach it with the clients and things?
Well, both. But I was asking more from a business side of things to say, how do you guys ensure that has success, or is there a structure to that?
I guess one of the things about being licensed through Hillross is that they've been really good at providing us with business coaching and support internally within the licensee. And of course, you've got to take that for what it is, because it's going to have a bit of a licensee flavor to it. But, you can pick the bits out that are going to benefit you and your clients and the way you do things. But I guess in the lead up to when I took over, which was been end of June 2015, I'd already been working in the business then for about 3 years. And so Phil and I had been a lot of the time having joint review meetings with a lot of our existing clients, sort of pre-positioning that long to ensure benefits for their own ongoing financial security and advice relationship. We were trying to put these steps in place to make sure that we could continue to look after them, even with, you know, with whatever Phil wanted to do as he went into retirement. So it was important that we didn't want it to be like a, right, Phil's done, here's Jay, there you go.
Yeah.
You know, start building relationships. Younger Phil. Young Phil. Yeah. Same guy, yeah, younger guy, more hair, whatever.
Better haircut.
Yeah. But he, we really deliberately try to have those combined meetings for quite a while to build up those relationships and make sure that the clients that have been, you know, a lot of them had been with the practice for, you know, 20 odd years, been with Phil since he started, a lot of them back in the AMP days, but that they knew me and felt comfortable with me to make sure that, look, as far as we're concerned, all the processes, everything they like about what we're doing just carry us on as it always has, but it's just they deal with me because I'm going to be there 5-6 days a week and Phil's there at the moment 2 to 3 at best. When he's not away enjoying his semi-retired
life. He's a motorbike
rider,
isn't he?
Yeah. So they've got a group of guys that do. Usually, I think it's every 12 months, they go away for about 4 weeks, 5 weeks or so, somewhere in the world riding motorbikes together and having, God knows what they get up to. Good times, I'm sure.
Yeah.
Plenty of drinking and, you know, carrying on.
Yeah, good on him. Yeah. So, like, you and you, like, I'm thinking the first, again, thinking about for guys listening to this, so, you're sitting in the meeting room with Dad, like in the first
Phil.
One.
Phil.
Phil. I sort of see in my mind that you're maybe doing the notes and like asking basic stuff, but he's driving, and then maybe the next time you're driving a bit more. Like how?
It was weird. Like we never really tried to sort of structure it to like I'd be like the junior guy doing the scribing or whatever. I mean, I've always kind of been known as that guy because I always take. Yeah. You know, I don't learn unless I write things down.
Yeah, you do write a lot.
I do. I don't know. Yeah, I always get the job of being the note taker when we do group stuff. But I don't know. I always found it pretty natural. A lot of it wasn't so much the strategy. It was just getting to know them and talking to them and building that rapport. And, you know, the strategy side of things comes, you know, down the track. Like that part of it was just more about getting to know them, getting to know me and feeling comfortable with me, knowing more about what's important for them and, you know, how we could work together and everything. So it actually felt pretty natural, really. We just quite conversational, like what we're doing now.
But that would have meant that Phil was sitting in the room, taking leaning back in the chair, letting you drive chunks of it.
I'd ask my own questions. He would, you know, it was just, as I said, it's just kind of very natural and conversational. You know, both of us would ask questions, and we both kind of, you know, Phil obviously had known a lot of these people for a very long time, so he's sort of given me bits of info that things that might be important. So I'm asking them about that
favorite footy team.
All the key stuff, you know, which children are getting left out of the will, all that.
It's important.
Yeah, so, no, it was good. And I think for anyone out there that's looking at that succession planning piece, giving yourself enough time to do it so it doesn't feel rushed or forced is, I think, can be really important because we didn't really lose very many clients at all as part of that transition, fortunately. Part of that was because we've had, you know, quite a high touch with most of our clients. And I didn't when I took over the practice, I didn't take over every single client because we traditionally had quite a large corporate super book, which I opted not to sort of participate in. When I took over, I just sort of kept our key clients that we knew and had good relationships with.
This is like Phil's port, like in gate, high touch port.
You know, with most of our clients, I don't know, 250 odd clients, and I had by that stage, you know, a number of my own clients as well that obviously came across. And
did you bring Horizons guys across?
Yeah, I did have some clients from those days, some friends that came on board with me in the Horizons days. You know, who I'm sure are paying way too low fees these days. Try to reward the ones that have been with me from the start, but, you know.
Yeah.
Fortunately, when I took over the business as well, at that time I was able to get a really good joint venture business off the ground with a group of accountants as well. So that was really useful because I'd taken on quite a mature business that had most people would be between 55 and 75, you know, still needing a lot of help with Centrelink and pensions and investments and all that, but definitely drawing down on a lot of their, you know, balances over time, which they should. So it was helpful to have another avenue, bringing some new clients in to sort of help keep everything balanced and give us plenty of new business to work with as well, which was, which has been great.
And that was, so was that your relationship?
It was, so Phil, actually, so it was with this group of accountants that they'd sort of done a similar thing to what Phil and I were doing, but going back a few years. So there was a younger accountant who'd taken over his father's practice.
So there's a 40-year-old Jade in the accounting
firm. Yeah, me fast forward a few years. So they'd been there and done that. So there's two directors. The younger one had taken over his father's practice. They were looking after Phil's own personal accounting, and we had quite a number of mutual clients that we'd both referred either way, just because we trusted each other's work anyway. But I guess it was probably around that time where a lot of the licensing was changing for accountants as well, around what they could and couldn't do. So they kind of recognised the need of having a good offering for their clients that they could, you know, have some input into as well. And we thought, well, it makes sense for us as well. We both like the way each other operates. So we ended up forming a JV business with them to provide services specifically for their clients and leverage off the capacity of the existing business that we had. So, and that's, about 4 years on now? It's going from strength to strength. So we're, really fortunate to have those guys on as partners with us.
Yeah. Out of your, day-to-day at the moment, what would you say the proportion of clients that you look after from the JV versus Phil's old guys?
I'd say the lion's share of new clients joining the practice are definitely from the JV business. Yeah. We still get quite a few referrals from existing clients.
Kids of Phil's clients? Or kids of your clients, I should say?
There's definitely the intergenerational thing. Not as much as I was probably expecting, but there's still a few that come through from that. I had a few other relationships with some lawyers out there as well, which have been great at referring a few clients through for various things. I think... Most of the new business would probably come from that relationship with the JV, and we deliberately structured it in a way that it would be beneficial to all parties involved. We wanted to get a win for the clients and a win for each of our businesses. Yeah. And I think that when you approach things from trying to just not ever win at somebody else's expense, but get mutual benefit out of it, that's where it succeeds. So
there's so much benefit. I'm fortunate to have a really good accounting relationship with someone, and I find it's helpful to have the Chinese wall system where it's like, I can't talk tax advice to clients and he can't talk advice to clients, but we can talk to each other about stuff and say, this is a tax thing I'm thinking about. I'm out of school. Yeah. What do you reckon? And he can say, financial planning, this.
Yeah.
And it's like, cool. And then we go to the client with this united front of just I've spoken, we're all sweet, and this is what we think.
Yeah, I think that it's definitely the way to go about doing it. And from a client's perspective, from what I've noticed just purely from our JV is that, you know, they love that integrated approach of knowing that, you know, their investment advice is going to overlap with their tax planning. And it's all managed by people that are on the same page with each other. Like our staff can communicate with each other as well to make sure that we can get things done, you know, efficiently for clients. And everyone seems to benefit out of it. And it's seriously so much easier for us dealing with clients like that than compared with some other accountants. Actually, we have got some other external accountants that we have nothing to do with who have been great, but some of them take ages to get things back that you need from them. And so it's definitely a more efficient way of doing it. And it's been great for us.
Cool.
Yeah.
That makes sense. I want to go back to the client transition thing, and I'm just sorry to bang on about it, but I think it's going to be helpful for a lot of guys.
Sure.
And girls or people. I'm just thinking were there any key issues that you saw keep coming up when you were talking to clients? As it sounded like Phil's the sort of character that maybe has a big enough ego that he doesn't need to, you know, assert himself for pride's sake and allow you to drive things. But I don't know. I'm thinking of the traditional, more classical type of advisor that might be, a bit of an ego.
Doesn't want to relinquish.
Yeah. It'd be tough, right? Because you're talking about not being the scribe in the early days. And I just wonder, maybe that's done you a big favor. Because I know when I first started out and I was an associate for a senior advisor, as I started to transition those relationships, I was always the young kid in the room, right? Yeah. So even when the senior's gone, you're still the young one, which is not good.
Well, yeah.
Yeah,
I can. Yeah, it depends on the personality of the people, I think, you know, and you just, if you want it to succeed, you just, as the older advisor, seeing it from my side of the fence, you just can't cling on to it and be too protective of it. Like, you know, if you want it to work, you've got to really make sure that you're giving the younger person every opportunity to succeed and giving them all the information and stuff that they need to pick up where you left off. But I had, it was interesting that as going through that process, and I said, as the demographic of our business is pretty old, so most of, well, older, 55 to 75, as most of them, I'd say.
That'd be pretty standard for the, you know, the...
I reckon it probably would.
Yeah.
But, for, you know, with a lot of them, they were saying, look, we're going through this same process with our dentists, our doctors, our lawyers, because, really? Like, a lot of the people have done this journey with the retiring.
Yeah, that's so true, man.
Thinking, well, geez, I don't want to be getting to my 80s and having to get a new doctor doesn't know anything about me, so they're actually, a lot of people already thinking that themselves, so getting their own things in order. So I guess it's kind of, you know, right place, right time.
Thankful.
And that, you know, I thinking back to that was that call I had to make with leaving Horizons, whether I'd stay in Sydney or not.
Yeah.
And I'm pretty glad that I made the call to get out and get involved with the business, or else I could have missed that opportunity. So
and you've kind of gone all in on the other, right? So it's like band versus this. Well, the timing worked out nicely.
Put all the cards down.
Nice, man. So what would you say for, like, for someone who, like, I mean, now you've got a team now.
Yeah.
So in a situation where you've got an advisor looking after a lot of your day-to-day, say, as you sort of grow as a business, at what point do you think it's appropriate for that younger advisor or for someone in a team to then say to you, as an owner, what's up?
No, I don't know. It's hard because, you know, and I've personally struggled with this with, I mean, I don't have an associate advisor at the moment. I still do pretty much everything end to end. I've got some really good support staff around me that do, you know, that help with, you know, the day-to-day stuff, but I'm still pretty much the guy for all the existing and new clients at this point in time, which will have to change at some stage. But I personally do find it difficult to, I'm probably doing some of the things I said not to do. I do find it hard to pass over that relationship for clients that I've got a really strong relationship with to somebody else, because then when somebody else picks it up, you're no longer that link to what's going on with them. So I'm sure there's...
Phil did it.
I know. He was ready to do it. He was at that end of his career.
You need a motorbike license, mate.
I know. But I'm sure, look, there's a million ways to successfully do that. Now, I know a lot of guys that are running practices with, you know, 5 to 10 advisors, and everyone's, you know, got a really good system of how to, you know, keep clients within the practice and make sure there's somebody there that can look after their needs and everything. We're probably, I don't know, maybe 12 months away from looking at taking on an associate advisor or somebody in that space. So I haven't had too much experience with it yet, but you know, I guess once you've done the hard yards and if you can prove yourself enough, then I guess there's a saying that somebody told me years ago, shy kids don't get any sweets. You just got to ask the question. And if it's, you know, if you see yourself as part of that practice for the long term and, you know, you feel like you're adding value to that practice and the clients, then I suppose there's no shame in putting your hand up and say, hey, look, I want to be part of this. How can we make this work?
Yeah. How would you feel if someone came to you that was an associate and said, hey, Jade, in 5 years, say, I want to be in a position where I'm at the table.
Yeah.
What do I need to do? Like, you'd respond well to that, right?
Yeah. I mean, you've got to, for the right people, I mean, it has to be the right personality fit. Because, I mean, if you bring anyone on as an equity owner in the business, you then essentially going into partnership with that person.
Yes.
I wouldn't do that with anyone that I don't think I have the same approach to ethics, the same approach to clients with. I know several people that I would be more than happy to do that with. But I think you would need to get the personalities and the approach right. I wouldn't want somebody who's just in there to, you know, do be an associate advisor for as quick as possible time and then try and think they can hop straight into being equity owner of the business.
Yeah.
I think that needs to, you know, you need to take your time, learn the ropes, show your value, show what you can add to that relationship as well to make it worthwhile for the other person bringing you on board. But definitely, I think it should be, you know, a natural progression for any associate advisor down the track if they, you know, if they love what they do and want to be part of that business.
So I imagine it's a struggle for a lot of people where, like, yes, absolutely, you don't want to rush into anything as a business owner, but also, like, I certainly have
retaining talent,
but also, like, for younger people not being led up a garden path.
Yeah.
Like, and I see so many situations where people have continued to prompt, and, like,
that carrot that's always just out of
reach.
Well,
the carrot that's always there, right? Yeah. And like, I don't know that on the other side of the coin is, are people having as, like, honest views as you to say, well, you know, I don't know. It's just an interesting one. And what I was thinking was how does someone start to understand whether or not it's a carrot or if it's a legitimate...
Or if you're just getting BS'd.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, it's hard. And I was just having this conversation with a client the other day who's a completely different industry, but the same issue. So it was a guy who was working for I think it was a pool maintenance business or something that was quite successful. But the guy had been telling him for years that he was going to, you know, he's going to step back, he's going to sell him some equity in the business, he was going to phase out. And it just never happened.
Yeah.
And, you know, he just kept getting jerked around. And it got to the stage where, you know, there was so much animosity built up from not having that opportunities that you thought were going to be there, that he had then gone out and set up his own business. And then some of the staff that were at that business have come across with him to set up his own business in competition with his old boss. And you can so see how that would happen. I mean, within our profession, you know, there is, you know, anti-competition, you know, non-compete clauses and various things like that. But, you know, if you BS somebody too long, they're gonna build resentment. They're gonna feel like you're stifling their career development, and, you know, they're not gonna care about disrupting your business one day. You know, you're much better off, I guess, to, you know, if you got that structure to try and facilitate somebody's growth and development within your business and retain them and be, you know, both be advocates of each other, and then everyone wins, I guess.
Yeah. Yeah, it's a tough one though, right? Because I could totally see if someone was overly ambitious walking into your business saying, "Hey Jade, I'm keen. Hey Jade, I'm keen. Hey Jade, I'm keen.
Yeah.
Hey Jade, this is the fourth time I've told you I'm keen." Mm. And it's like, well, hang on, mate. Like, I'm happy for this, but you've been here for 4 minutes.
it all comes down to time frames. And I guess it's a, you know, there's no one size fits all. It's going to be a case by case situation with how people are. You know, if I had somebody walk into my office and say, "Yeah, I want this job, and you know, 5 years I want to be a partner in this business," I'd be like, "Well, okay, like, just call your jets there, mate." You know, I think
nice to meet you. I'm Jade.
Yeah. Right. I would probably say, look, you know, I want to see what you can bring to the table first before we know that. But I think as a business owner, you do need to be honest with people. And if it's not going to happen, don't keep feeding the old, you know, it's going to happen at some stage, because, you know, it's just going to burn people out and piss people off. So.
Mm.
I guess it's a fine line, isn't it, between wanting to foster development and having good staff and longevity in your business, but not wanting to, you know, do it too soon or before you've kind of earned your stripes a bit.
Mm.
You got to really want to put the hard yards in first, otherwise you won't appreciate it.
Yeah, I suppose like it's having honest conversations with people, right? It's a fascinating one. I see it all the time, and I just, like, as that average age of an advisor continues to get older, and you start to see this, I just see, like, these conversations are going to happen more and more and more. And I feel like the transition of businesses might become more of a thing as the bowlers start to drop and, you know, people start looking at EBIT, and it's more of a traditional business structure valuation.
I think it's happening across the board with other professions, other industries as well. You know, just the demographics of our country are, we've got an aging population. So many people are faced with this kind of stuff. And just even on a, you know, segueing into an advice sort of perspective, you know, there's so much opportunity there to work with people on their succession planning, and because a lot of people just never think about it. You know, they think, oh, look, at some stage I'm going to pull the plug on my business and get paid some money somehow, and that's going to be my retirement.
Mm.
No real idea of how that will actually happen, how they're going to facilitate that. You know, so it's important for all of us to think about it and get things in order, you know.
Do you do that stuff? Like that
I don't specialise in that sort of stuff. Specifically, I mean, we do a bit of it around people that are retiring, around, you know, the small business CGT concessions and whatnot, but not specifically estate planning, but, you know, we obviously have those conversations a lot with the accounting clients, the joint clients as well, because the accountants have got a pretty big hand in how that can work. But, I mean, it's just an important conversation to have.
Totally.
Otherwise,
yeah.
People just you start thinking about it too late, and it's too difficult to plan. Yeah. You haven't got time.
I just went through the advice process with a 40-something-year-old, and like we asked people to do a budget on like their day-to-day expenses, yeah. And he it was impossible for him to strip out his personal expenses to the business. Like, yeah. It was just so
intertwined.
So intertwined,
they?
And like
yeah,
I'm not a business owner, right? Like as a day-to-day traditional type of owner, so it was difficult for me, and I could see it's less of a problem when you're 40 and you're working day-to-day. It's you know the can got kicked up the road a little bit, but I imagine if you're 60 and you're that person, like tough to provide advice.
Well, I mean. It's kind of like that. It's the same thing as like that client that comes to you and they're about to retire and says, "Oh, look, I should probably start thinking about my super now." Hey, I'm like, well, mate, where were you 10 years ago? Well, yeah. We should have been. Well, 20 years ago, we should have been planning this sort of stuff. You know, you've got to allow time for these things to work, or otherwise, you try and force them without the time, yeah. And you know, you're not going to get the outcome that you want potentially. You know? Which is why I was glad that, like with Phil. You know, fortunately, we had that family connection, so we were able to start working on that together from a fairly early stage. And, you know, it was pretty much a 2 to 3 year sort of lead up to when I took over.
When you were doing.
Yeah.
Was Phil your main? Because one of the things I wanted to ask you was leaving AMP Horizons into here. Like, for those that haven't done AMP Horizons, like, I know AMP cops it, but does. Like Horizons legitimately like really good. The academy was really collegiate. I've met some of the best people in my life out of the people from there. But like it's a lot of XY advisor and like sharing advice and ideas was born from you know like the Clayton, Adrian, and myself having that, and you as well.
I mean, I see a lot of those names that are on the forums and things that we're posting on are guys that I recognise from Horizons or in the network and various, you know, AP charter, Ross sort of guys that I know. So
yeah,
it does.
You jump on a plane now, you're in Adelaide, so you've got Phil there. So how where did you get your resource? Like what? How did you do that?
Just got on the bike and started pedaling. No, you know, well, fortunately, I think coming from that, doing that 12 months in the practice through Horizons really did, fortunately, give me the skill set to kind of hit the ground running, I think. If I hadn't have done that, I would have been floundering for a lot longer. It would have taken me a lot longer to kind of get in the flow of what do I do day to day? How do I be productive? Mm. What does my ideal week look like? Excuse me, all of that sort of stuff. So I guess as soon as I got back from Sydney to Adelaide, it was pretty much like, well, here's a client list. Start calling people, make relationships, see what comes of it, see who you can help, what can you do, and just hit the ground running like exactly what we were doing in the Horizons space, which. You know, it was tough, but fortunately, you know, I'd had that background of doing truckloads of phone calls every day.
Yeah.
You know, you just got to get on the phone and be in touch with people. You know, you can't have that call reluctance or be nervous to speak to people. You just have no choice but to get out there, speak to as many people as you can, see as many people as you can, and just see what you can do for people. And Phil was obviously the main mentor I had there because I was working pretty closely with him. But I had, you know, other guys who I'm really close with who had been advisors for longer than I had, who, you know, we're sharing ideas and kind of doing our own sort of mini peer group type things, which I think are really important, you know.
In Adelaide?
You know, just a few of us from different licensees, and we'd catch up and just talk about what's going on and ways we're approaching different things. And, you know, our cool. Stuff's always changing. So having other people you can just bounce ideas off, like what we do on the XY forum, you know, it's great to have that. But we were kind of doing that on a mini, mini scale, just between, you know, three or four of us.
It'd be tough, man. Like, I always thought it's like, well, now you're there. I imagine you day to day you see a lot of more conventional stuff going on in business. Yeah. Like, well, hang on, I've got all these ideas, and like after a year or so, I just want like how do you re get the the sunlight, but like how do you re get energize yourself to say, okay, well,
I think the hardest transition for me was going from being an advisor and just seeing clients and all that to then being a business owner. I found that a massive sort of mindset shift that I'm probably still, you know, still wrestling with in my daily sort of routine, because it is such a different thing to not just, you know, for me, I feel like the advising is the easy part. coming up with fresh ideas for the business on how we look after clients, how do we deal with the ever-changing compliance framework we're dealt with, how do we do things better, more efficiency, leverage technology. But at the same time, we've got all these clients we need to put in the hours to see and review and do things for. It's really hard to kind of keep all those plates spinning. I'm sure any small business owner or people, you know, with practices would, you know, especially in the early days, agree that it is hard to get the balance right, because the part of the job I fell in love with was being an advisor and seeing people and the relationships, but then all of a sudden you're responsible for staff and hiring and everything else that comes along with it. And yeah, it's challenging to know how much time of your day you devote to each of those areas, and where do you go for help if you want to, like, you know, as I said, I had only done it. I'd been in the role for about 3 years before I took over. I'd been, you know, had other experiences that sort of helped me with some of it, but, you know, it's hard to know where to go for help to develop things and make sure that you can implement different strategies in your business whilst keeping it running.
Where do you go for, where have you gone for that? Is that a Hillross thing? Because you mentioned the business coaching, or the guys that are here.
So I do with Chris, who's my accountant and also partner in the JV business. I do quarterly business sessions with him, coaching sessions. So as part of that, we revisit all the P&Ls of the business. We have a look at, you know, what are some of the projects we've got coming up? What are some of the things that we're going to need to devote time to within the practice? What are a couple of things we want to achieve before the next quarterly catch up? So, you know, whilst we might not get every single one of those things ticked off by the time we catch up again, at least if we can get one or two of them done, it's a step in the right direction that I might not have done if I hadn't been having those conversations. So I find it really beneficial for me to have that partnership with Chris. But I'm sure there's, you know, other external people you could pay to go to those kind of things, I guess. But I sort of ended up doing that just because that was a service that Chris offered, and I knew that he knew my business intimately and was objective from it. Because I guess I didn't want to be having those conversations with Phil because he's too close to the business and he's always done it a certain way. I wanted to get somebody with fresh insights from outside.
An objective thing would be
no bias
well.
For it, and just to give me some fresh ideas about what we could do. And that's been helpful. But it's still challenging just with this finite number of hours you got in the day to kind of do everything you want
time.
To do.
Yeah, it's a bit like, I mean, like, feel like I'm on a bandwagon now, but it's a bit like with clients where it's like, if they cancel the review because they've got a busy work day, it's like, well, man, why are you working?
Yeah, yeah, exactly. You know? It is like that.
I feel like 90 days is really good. You mentioned 90 days with the accountant. It's 90 days is this, we do it at XY as well. Yeah. And I like 90 days, really good runway, because it's like, it's short enough that you're engaged in the project, but it's also long enough that you can deep dive into stuff.
Yeah.
Is that, so that's,
yeah,
that's,
I mean, yeah, I mean, I'm not sure how we arrived at that. It just quarterly sounds good. And it was, like you say, you know, it's short enough that by the time you go back to it, it hasn't been 12 months and you think, oh, Jesus, what do we talk about? You can be held to account for some of the things you want to achieve. Yeah. But I think I've still probably found it challenging to have a business that's been around for, you know, 25, 30 years before I took over, with a lot of existing processes and practices around, you know, the investment management side of things and the way that we, you know, manage our client relationships, to try and think about how we could reinvigorate that or bring it into a more modern approach.
Yeah. What is the more modern approach? How have you done that?
Well, to be honest, like, fortunately, the way that the practice had been running for at least the last 10 years before I took over was that with all of our full service clients, we were on yearly renewable agreements with everyone.
Yeah.
So we've kept that going. But what has probably changed is, you know, historically we've had more of a, you know, come in whenever you need to. If it's a couple of times a year, come in a couple of times a year. If you don't need to come in this year, we'll check in with you, make sure it's all good, and then, you know, drop in when you want to.
Yep.
But it's kind of moved to now you need to formally review everybody every 12 months to make sure that you can continue providing the services, which I have to admit, for some clients, they actually don't really want to come frequently. But for us to continue looking after things as we do, we have to.
Yeah.
So that's probably meant that we've increased our review workload by, I'd say, maybe a quarter to a third, maybe a quarter or so.
Solid chunk.
Enough that it's
especially
it's
when it's a third of people that are like, I don't know why we're talking, Jane. Yeah. Like, I apologize. Can you just...
we do what we need to do. We want to make sure, obviously, that everything's kosher and everyone's getting looked after. But a lot of the time, you know, you may not need it every single 12 months, but then sometimes it's two or three times a year. So anyway, that's been a change that we've just had to manage from more of a time you know, time in the diary perspective, because that obviously eats into time you can be seeing new clients and working on other things, because we just have to review everyone, and that's all good, which we're doing. But yeah, it's you know, then just also then thinking about what's our client communication strategies, how do we leverage you know, technology to handle more of that stuff, how do we personalize things a bit more as well. You know, it's ever evolving.
I feel like you could provide the clients with a Christmas soundtrack.
Best of, you know, Michael a la Michael Bublé or something.
Yeah.
Oh, God. No, thank you. But, we still do handwritten Christmas cards.
You do? Yeah, man. There's stuff, a lot to be said for handwritten, man.
I can't believe how many people comment on that.
Yeah.
Like,
you got good handwriting as well.
It's not, well, it's all right. It gets a bit sloppy when you're doing, you know, 40 cards at a time or something. And I'm always just on the cusp of getting them out. But they, surprising how many clients still, when you call them, they say, look, thank you so much for that birthday card. It was the only one I got this year. Wow. Really nice that somebody cares enough to do that. And whilst you're doing it at the time and it does take up a big chunk, you think, oh, God, is it, do people even really care? Like, they do, surprisingly.
You know, there's
human interaction.
Oh, for sure. And I wonder if, like, have you found that, like, it's a good thing for you? Because, like, in psychology, there's this thing around, like, if you spend, mindfulness is a version of this, but, like, spending time, like, I call it half an hour a month writing birthday cards.
Yeah.
It's like just on that appreciation or like that gesture changes your thinking a little bit. I wonder, like,
Well, I mean, all I can say is that I know people do appreciate it. I frequently get comments from people saying that it made their day, or, you know, sometimes I had a guy the other day, I sent him out a card and our pen, and just a plan four pen. And he said, oh, my other pen just ran out. It made my day getting that new pen. I thought, God, something as small as that, you know, it's worth doing. Yeah, you know, it is worth doing. So, yeah. Got to keep in touch with people.
For sure, man. A couple of things before we wrap up.
Yep.
What are you curious about right now?
Curious about? From a business perspective, I guess systemizing, automation, workflow, all that sort of stuff, because it's something that we've been trying to do for such a long time. Like, we made the transition from coin to X-Plan probably 12 months
ago. Everyone seems to be doing that. What?
From us, we could just see that coin was getting zero upgrades funding, and it was just sort of pretty antiquated in the way that it did things. Like, we wanted to be getting more data feeds, better reporting for clients through our CRM, and
same old story.
Yeah, and X-Plan seemed to do a lot of that. I hadn't had any experience with it before we took it on. I'm still, you know, fairly average at it, using it to its potential, but fortunately some of our power planners and things have had a lot of experience with it, and risk researcher and all the data feeds and whatnot. So I think for us, trying to just go through end to end of our review clients, new business processes, all of that, and workflow at all, just to make sure that, you know, it is very easy to just miss small things when you're left to human interaction with it all.
Yes.
It can happen. We're only human. So if the less chance we have of people, you know, doing that, the better. So that's something that we'd like to see fully up and running in the next couple of months. You know, but I'm forced to be curious about the FASIA exam.
Yeah, man.
So, yeah.
Have you done any stuff for it?
I've just started the ethics module with Kaplan. So my sort of, I've just finished the grad dip. So my next, trying to finish the master's four units next, and doing the ethics module at the moment. So my plan was to do the ethics module and then do the FASIA exam after I finished that, just to, it's a little fresh in my mind. But, you know, the education stuff is a massive chunk of your time, and you know, I'm not sure whether I'll end up doing CFP and getting that, but I definitely want to get the master's finished off over the next 12-18 months or so. So that's something I have to be curious about, and I want to be. I do want to be, but I just need to get it done.
Yeah. So you need to do master's and ethics and the exam. Is that?
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. What's under your belt at the moment?
Education-wise, well, I've just finished the grad dip,
okay.
Which is, so I finished the eighth module of that only a few weeks ago.
So four more for masters,
including the ethics one.
Oh, happy days.
Yeah, so the ethics can count as far as I'm aware, it can count as a one of the elective subjects.
I think they changed that last week.
Of course they blamed me. Just like when we got credit for things after I'd already finished them. But, we got some credit, I think, for Horizons or something, but it was already after I'd finished that next level lot of studies, so I didn't get to use it.
Yeah, good.
But yeah, so, you know, that's obviously something that's on the agenda for the next 12 months or so.
I did the practice exam last week.
How'd you go?
I don't know yet. So the results come over the next couple of weeks. It's a weird one, man, because it's not a technical exam.
Yeah.
But it's really about a lot of hypothetical situations, talking about like relative to standard 8 question. It's like,
I kind of find it difficult when it's like, you know, which one of these is the most wrong? You're like, God, it's very subjective. How do you know? I kind of wish I don't feel like they need to be as tricky as they are with some of these things to weed out unethical behaviour. But, you know, so be it. We jump through the hoops.
Yeah, I feel like a lot of people are just leaning into it. I've got the actual exam in December, and with a bit of luck, that'll be...
Yeah,
that'll be it. So once that's done, I'll be delighted to talk people through that. But it's navigating the Corporates Act, really big one. That's like super important.
It's a big act.
It's a big act. Yeah, man. Hundreds of pages. That's why I say navigating the act, because it'll ask about something relative to the Corporations Act. But if you know how to find the particular area.
Yeah, look, I imagine it's like anything. You got to just put in the time to
to
get to know it. And, you know, for those of us that have got, the right intentions at heart and know right from wrong, hopefully with a bit of brushing up on that sort of stuff, we should be able to sail through it all. So I'm not too worried. It's just more just finding the time with everything else to get it done, which we will do.
Sweet. Very finally. If we're organising a dinner party, just you and one other person, one other person, dead or alive, who would it be and why? God. You can have two if you're struggling.
Oh, jeez. God.
Graham doesn't count.
For some reason, like without thinking about it, the first person that came to my mind was Kurt Cobain. I have to go back to my music days, never got to see Nirvana play live, but geez, I'd love to pick Kurt's brains about,
Cobain and Warren Buffett.
Yeah. A bit of each, yeah. Geez, that'd be an interesting. I don't know whether that'd go terribly.
You'd be stressed out, mate. You would not enjoy that. Yeah.
You don't want those two people in the room together. But no, I'd love to meet, would have loved to meet Kurt and got to know about his creative influences and, you know, things that go into his songwriting and process and everything. But yeah, not to be. That will never happen, unfortunately. Yes. Yeah. So RIP.
Yeah, take Kurt Cobain. Yep. All right, man. Good to see you.
Yep, you
Thanks
too.
For your time. And
thanks for having me.
We'll catch up soon.
Yeah, cheers. Thanks.